Good morning and welcome to the 21st meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2022. The first item on our agenda is pre-budget scrutiny. The committee has agreed to focus its pre-budget scrutiny on how the Scottish Government plans to fund its COVID recovery strategy and the ongoing costs associated with the pandemic as set out in the COVID-19 strategic framework. We will begin this morning's meeting discussing the work of the Scottish Government Standing Committee on Pandemic Preparedness, which has been published as an interim report on the 30th of August. I would like to welcome Professor Andrew Morris, the Chair of the Standing Committee, to the meeting, who joins us remotely. Thank you for giving us your time this morning. Each member will have approximately 7 minutes to speak to Professor Morris and to ask questions. We are due to speak to the Deputy First Minister at 9:45, so I apologise in advance if time runs on too much. I may have to interrupt members or the witness in the interest of brevity. Can I invite you, Professor Morris, to just briefly introduce yourself and the work of the Standing Committee? Okay, sorry, Professor Morris, can you hear me? I think there might be some technical issues. Put your hand up if you can hear me.
We can.
He can't. Okay. We'll just wait one moment while we try and rectify our technical issues. Okay, I'm going to briefly suspend the meeting and we might try to reconnect. Thank you. Good morning and welcome back to the 21st meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2022. We were having some technical problems, but I hope they've now been resolved. Can you hear me, Professor Morris?
Good morning. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Fantastic. Good morning, and I'd like to welcome Professor Andrew Morris, who is the Chair of the Standing Committee, to the meeting, who joins us remotely. Thank you for giving us your time this morning. I'm just clarifying that you can hear me. Okay. We still have some technical issues, so I will unfortunately have to suspend again until we can rectify this, so apologies. Good morning and welcome back for the third time to the 21st meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2022. Apologies, but we have had some technical issues this morning, so I'm hoping they're resolved. And can you hear me, Professor Morris?
Good morning, and it's a pleasure to be here for the third time.
Wonderful.
And I apologise, convener and members of the committee, for not being with you in person.
No, that's fine. At least we've got you now. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. Well, I'm just going to welcome Professor Andrew Morris. He's the chair of the Standing Committee to the meeting and is joining us obviously remotely today. And thank you very much for giving us your time this morning. We are short of time now, so I think members will really only have about 4 minutes each for a question. We do have the Deputy First Minister coming in, Professor Morris, at 9:45. So I apologise in advance if time runs on too much. I may have to interrupt members or yourself in the interests of brevity. Professor Morris, can I ask you just to briefly introduce yourself and the work of the Standing Committee?
So, good morning, and it's a privilege to be invited to present to the committee. So my name's Andrew Morris, I'm a doctor. My specialty is diabetes, and I was Chief Scientist for Health in Scotland for the Scottish Government from 2012 to 2017. And since 2014, I've been Professor of Medicine at the University of Edinburgh, but seconded to London for the last 4 years as the Director of a National Technology Institute, Health Data Research UK. So it's ironic that I've had the technology challenges today. Since February 2020, I was invited by the First Minister to be the independent chair of the Scottish Government Standing Committee on Pandemic Preparedness, and I do this on a voluntary basis. The aim of the committee is to deliver on the commission of the First Minister, which was delivered to us on the 5th of April, to do four things. Firstly, to advise Scottish Government on threat intelligence assessment and response. Secondly, to define priorities for research. Thirdly, to strengthen the response infrastructure. And lastly, consider priorities for Scotland in the context of UK risk assessment. And the work is very much ongoing, and I look forward to the discussions today.
Thank you very much, Professor Morris. I'll now turn to questions, and if I may begin by asking the first question. Thank you for the interim report which your committee has published, and I note that the full report will be published this time next year. The first thing that struck me was the first paragraph in the introduction, which said, "Pandemics are inevitable and are likely to occur more frequently in the future than in the past." So I think basically, my question is, why is it that they're going to occur more frequently in the future? And is it anticipated that they're going to have the same severity as COVID-19?
So there's lots of uncertainty. What we do know is that novel human pathogens occur very frequently. I think the WHO suggests that in the last 50 years, there are 1,500 new pathogens. And many folks say that we've been lucky that the last major pandemic to affect humanity was in 1918. And in fact, since the year 2000, we've probably had six to seven major scares, whether it's SARS, whether it's MERS. The other comment is that, with the exception of smallpox, that's the only ever disease that's ever really been eradicated. And many others are hanging around. For example, the plague struck in Madagascar in 2017, affecting about 2,000 people and killing 200 people. So we live in a world where infectious disease and pathogens are a constant threat. And as we know, international travel is a big issue. For example, I think in 2019, pre-pandemic, there were about 1.4 billion international arrivals globally, compared with 25 million in 1950. So the fact that pathogens, we're living with pathogens, a new pathogen, and the fact that we live in a global ecosystem means that pandemics will always be a constant. And I think this has been recognised in Scotland and the UK in terms of, you know, the UK risk register. Pandemics pre-pandemic were actually in the far right quadrant. So I just think this is a fact for humanity, but there's an opportunity for us to do something about it.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you very much for that answer. I'm going to move to Murdo Fraser, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Professor. Thanks for joining us. I just got one question I wanted to ask around your paper and your recommendation 3, which is about the need to develop stronger linkages to Scottish, UK and international scientific advisory structures and networks and agencies. We saw during the 2 years when we had the COVID pandemic, politicians in different parts of the United Kingdom taking different decisions at times, but essentially basing their decisions on scientific advice, which one would have assumed was largely the same in different parts of the UK. Does that, in your view, point to a need for more cooperation when it comes to decisions being taken, for example, about bringing in restrictions, or is this just an inevitability that politicians will go their own way, or does it point to the need for scientists to work closer together?
So I think this is a key issue, and I should comment that one of my other responsibilities, I was invited by the CMO to convene the Scottish Government Chief Medical Officer's COVID-19 Advisory Group. And two comments there. We met 66 times, I think, and provided 44 pieces of advice to Scottish Government. But most importantly, I and others participated in the UK SAGE process convened by Patrick Valance and Chris Whitty. And when I was invited to participate in SAGE, I thought I was really important because this scientific advice is emergent, but reciprocity and collaboration on scientific advice has to be completely unified. Because the role of scientists is not to set policy, it's to provide the best evidence, the best consensual advice that is available at the time, recognizing that during pandemics there's huge uncertainty. It's then for politicians to make difficult decisions about policy. So I'm really clear that the scientific community needs to collaborate nationally and internationally to curate that best advice that then can be acted upon by politicians. So in terms of where we are in Scotland, we've got excellent chief scientific advisory structures. They link into the UK well, but as ever, I think there's an opportunity to do two things. Firstly, strengthen the structures in Scotland. And secondly, ensure that they are completely integrated, at the very least, with UK structures. Because science is independent, or science is agnostic of sovereign borders, if I put it that way.
OK, thank you very much.
Thank you. Can I move to Alex Rowley, please?
Good morning, Professor Morris. I just have one question, which is really around the effectiveness of the spend on COVID. So during the pandemic, I think it would be fair to say that money did not become a barrier in terms of trying to tackle and deal with COVID, but how effective it was then and how best, given we now live in much more tighter financial times, are you looking at how effective spend is or should be in terms of being prepared for further risks?
Okay, so that's a very good question. It's not my my job to comment on the spend in the pandemic that we've just had, because there'll be an inquiry and others are better positioned to comment on that, although I'm sure I might be invited to the inquiry. But what I think that the opportunity we have with the standing committee is to think, what does really good look like for Scotland in the context of a global ecosystem in terms of pandemic preparedness? So what we've done is try to do three things. Firstly, be very practical. Secondly, to consider what would an outstanding pandemic preparedness system look like in the context of Scotland, in terms of our health structures, in terms of the academic community, in terms of our linkage with health and social care, and in terms of our linkage with policy makers and industry. And lastly, what we've done is ongoing, is trying to learn from the best internationally. So I think that moving forward, we've got to do this with humility, and be prepared to learn from international examples. But my sense in terms of how we structure this, looking forward, I don't anticipate a major new budget line for pandemic preparedness. The two principles of this is that for good pandemic preparedness, you need a very good, strong health and care system. So that is the foundation of good pandemic preparedness. And secondly, when we look at the components of good pandemic response, I think there are perhaps three or four areas that we can do better, and they may need targeted strategic investment just to get them into a very good place.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Jim Fairley.
Thanks very much, Convener. What kind of body would the Centre for Pandemic Preparedness be? So would it be a statutory body or a non-departmental public body? How do you envisage that looks? What does it feel like to be brought into?
So it's a good question. And I always say form follows function. So rather than thinking what structure is this, we should consider what functions that we're seeking that body to perform. And then, I always say governance follows structure, follows function, follows purpose. So the work we're currently doing is being razor sharp to say, what functions and purpose should that body deliver on behalf of the Scottish population? And there are four or five principles to that. Firstly, we want that body to transform medical defences. So it coalesces Scottish expertise in vaccines, therapeutics, diagnostics. Secondly, ensuring so-called situational awareness, and that's the data piece. So early warning systems, and then real-time monitoring of any outbreak, epidemic or pandemic. Thirdly, be very tightly integrated with our NHS social care bodies and Public Health Scotland, because as I said, the foundation of any good pandemic response is to have it embedded in a health system. And then to ensure clarity around leadership, who gets up in the morning every day and is responsible for pandemics. So, to my mind, this is not about bricks and mortar. It's about a centre of expertise that brings together outstanding talent that already exists in Scotland. I think Scotland is a good place to bring this expertise and leadership together. And there actually is a model supported by the Scottish Government. You may be aware that the Rural and Environment Science and Analytical Services supports something called EPIC, which is Expertise on Animal Disease Outbreaks. And what that consortium does is bring expertise together in veterinary medicine, epidemiology, genetics, physics, math, statistics, to deliver value to the Scottish Government. Bringing this, I think it's a virtual centre, and it's a virtual centre that addresses policy relevant questions in peacetime as well as during emergencies. Now, how we structure that and put the governance across it, I think, is open to consultation and discussion. But we need to be crystal clear about the functions.
OK, thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Professor Morris. You mentioned early on in your introduction that, you know, global pandemic is one of the highest risks that we continually face, and I think we always knew that there was a global pandemic was going to happen at some point, kind of like an asteroid strike. You just hope it doesn't happen during your tenure, and I think it's fair to say most governments, if not all governments, weren't properly prepared for it. And I also think as we watched the pandemic move across the globe, we recognised that the ages are an issue. Obesity, diabetes, all the other conditions made people more vulnerable. So I wonder then, in their preparedness and recognising that we need to prepare better, are you considering a more focused approach in dealing with the pandemic, and where, you know, behavioural science fits into this, both from a government perspective and what we can expect and to ask our population to do?
So there's a couple of responses to that. I think, you know, it's a very good question, because what I think there's a risk of currently is of complacency. You know, we're seeing COVID subside a little, although we're likely to see another surge in the winter months. And with flu, there's a risk of a twindemic. But there is a risk that we turn the world's attention away from the risk, and that we don't do justice to pandemic preparedness. Because just to be clear, no, I think we need to take action now while we remember how awful this pandemic has been and feel the urgency of trying to stop the next one. And also, you know, we shouldn't assume the next one will look exactly like COVID. It could be deadlier and more infectious, and it might be designed by humans. Because biosecurity is a big risk. So in terms of how we set ourselves up, it is about this interdisciplinarity I talked about earlier. And one of the benefits of the COVID pandemic is how we've integrated behavioral science into the physical, biomedical, and computational sciences. And in the early days of the pandemic, we were completely dependent on not so-called non-pharmaceutical interventions, which is the things we know: physical distancing, hand washing, isolation, etc. And actually, the publics, I think, responded very well. So, as we move forward in pandemic preparedness, integration and respect of behavioural science and working with the publics is going to be key to good pandemic preparedness. And a final comment, I might, you know, it's not my area of expertise, but I've been trying to learn about risk. And actually, there was a House of Lords Select Committee report I would commend. It was cross-party, published on the 3rd of December, called Preparing for Extreme Risks, Building a Resilient Society. And there were several conclusions to that, which I think are relevant to our work. Firstly, the UK went into that with too much self-confidence, actually. Secondly, there's excessive secrecy, and actually we need to be, you know, the public behaved well, and you need to inform them if you expect them to respond to risks. So, thirdly, we need to challenge systems. And by that, I mean, moving forward, I think having exercises that test our pandemic preparedness will be very important. If we don't have exercises to test how well we're doing, we're likely to fail. And lastly, and it links to your questions, you know, we often look at risks as discrete risks, whereas there's this concept of cascade risks. Who, for example, before COVID would have envisaged the impact on exam results? So it's that cascade component of risk. But behavioural science is absolutely key to pandemic preparedness, and you're quite right to highlight it.
Thank you. Can I move to John Mason? I know that you raised some really valid points there, so we might have time for supplementaries after John. Just
okay, thanks very much, convener. Professor, if I can just clarify, this is an interim report, and I noted in your chair's summary it says these are important and achievable ambitions to which the Scottish Government and its partners will wish to respond. So are you expecting a response from the Government to the interim report, and then that will feed into your final report?
So thank you, Mr. Mason. Yeah, it's a good question. So I am anticipating a response to this interim report. Next steps, would you like to articulate next steps of how you...
Yes, I think that'd be helpful. Yes, please. Yes.
Okay. So I'm very fortunate to be supported by a fantastic group of experts, as well as two outstanding deputy chairs in terms of Chief Scientist Health, Anna Dominicek, and the Chief Scientific Advisor, who is Julie Fitzpatrick. But we're approaching this knowing that we don't know everything. So this is our initial report. So over the next 12 months, we're going to do several things. Firstly, we've set up four so-called task and finish groups to look at each of the four main recommendations, to flesh them out in terms of their purpose, their function, their leadership, their structure, governance, and resource implications. Secondly, we're going to go around Scotland, actually, I've suggested, because, you know, this is a Scottish report. So I've suggested to the team that we hold regional meetings across, so we get out of Edinburgh, and we consult in a very open and transparent way with the publics, as well as the learned societies, the Royal Society of Edinburgh, SSAC, NHS, social care colleagues. And thirdly, we have set up an international reference group with some of the world's, very small group, but some of the world's most distinguished experts on pandemic preparedness. And that group will meet three times. And transparency is key. So all our minutes and all our activities will be published openly. And the purpose of that is that I hope we'll get to the best quality product that we can. But I do anticipate an initial response from Scottish Government and a final response when we publish the report in about 12 months' time.
Okay, that's very helpful to understand the way ahead. Helpful? Yes, no, that's super. If I may just ask quite a few things I'd like to ask, but specifically, I mean, you said one of the key things is having a health system that's strong and robust to start with. And some people would say, well, we should have hundreds of extra beds in hospitals sitting empty most of the time, so that when a pandemic comes or similar, we're kind of all ready for it. But there obviously would be a cost to that. I mean, have you any thoughts about how we, you know, balance up this kind of spending on preventative measures or reactive measures? Because clearly we're under financial pressure at the moment. And if we have labs sitting empty, if we have hospitals sitting empty, you know, there is a cost.
Yeah, it is. It is a good question, and there's tension in the system. But this is why I think we need to look at how we integrate some of this expertise, capability, and resources within business as normal and peacetime, and be able to pivot as required. Let me take one example, genomic sequencing. Now, as part of, you'll recall that the PCR test is like molecular photocopying in it for the diagnosis of COVID. It told us whether you had it or not. To be able to follow how the virus is mutating, you need to do sequencing. And that is part of core pandemic preparedness. Now, in peacetime, we should be applying genomic sequencing to other respiratory pathogens because it can help support excellent quality-based care in normal NHS services. But to have that capability, you can then pivot during the times of the pandemic so that it's ready, primed, and can respond rapidly rather than having to build it from scratch. What we learned in the pandemic is build on what you've got rather than start new initiatives. So I think tricky decisions will have to be made, but across a raft of capabilities, we should be asking, how can we bake this into a, an excellent NHS and public health system for Scotland? And finally, a lot of this is coordination and connectivity rather than huge new investment. It's about alignment of expertise and alignment of capability on a Scotland-wide basis, so we avoid duplication and waste in the system. So it's about efficiency as well. But it is a difficult equation.
Okay, thanks. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm conscious we've got about 3 minutes, but I'm going to bring Brian Whittle in for a very brief supplementary.
Thank you. I'm delighted to get the opportunity to ask Professor Morris another question. I think if you ask a clinician, how are we going to prevent the spread of a sort of pathogen, they would say, don't go outside and don't meet anybody else, and that will definitely prevent that from happening. So there's a tension between the sort of that pure health science, if you like, of dealing with a pandemic against our continual learning of non-COVID related impact of the COVID response, and we're continuing to learn that. So how is that being baked into your thought process and the development of this study?
The non-COVID related harm.
Yes.
So that's a good question. Well, I'm very keen, that this committee, our commission is to focus on the health risks, but it's right and proper we have awareness of the wider societal and economic risks. And I think that as part of our work, it would be right and proper that we attempt to do a cost-benefit analysis of pandemic preparedness. And that's tricky. I actually looked at the literature, and there are actually very few studies internationally that have evaluated cost-benefit of performed an economic evaluation of infectious respiratory disease at scale. But moving forward, I think that is something for the government to consider is how do you balance the cost benefit of not only the health interventions but the economic components. So it will be part of our work, and I think it should be, but we'll be seeking external advice.
Thank you. And I thank Professor Morris for his evidence and giving us your time this morning, and apologies for the technical issues that we had in the beginning. If you'd like to raise any further evidence with the committee, please do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you about how to do this. I will now briefly suspend the meeting to allow Professor Morris to leave. Thank you. Good morning. I now move to the second agenda item, in which we will conclude our pre-budget scrutiny by taking evidence from the Scottish Government. I would like to welcome to the meeting John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, Simon Mair, Deputy Director of COVID Recovery and Public Sector Reform, Andrew Watson, Director of Budget and Public Spending, and Christine McLaughlin, Director of Population Health. Thank you for your attendance this morning and welcome. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any remarks before we move on to questions?
Thank you, Convener. I'm grateful to the committee for the opportunity to discuss a number of matters relating to our recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic and our preparedness for any future waves. In February 2022, the Scottish Government published a revised strategic framework which set out our long-term approach to managing COVID-19 and its associated harms. The strategic framework was published as we entered a calmer phase of the pandemic, and I'm pleased that for the most part we've remained in this calmer phase for some time. COVID-19 may not be at the forefront of everyone's minds in the way it was last winter, but the Scottish Government remains prepared to respond appropriately and proportionately to any new wave or variant that could emerge. The strategic framework supports the Scottish Government to manage future threats through adaptations to our behaviours and physical environments, as well as through effective vaccination and treatment. Ongoing surveillance of infection levels and potential new variants will also support our management of future threats. It is important to note that we are progressing well with ongoing booster vaccinations, and those in the most vulnerable groups will have been offered an appointment by the start of December. I'm confident that the strategic framework ensures we have the necessary resilience and preparedness to meet any potential challenges we might face in the months ahead. The Scottish Government's COVID recovery strategy, which was published in October 2021, focuses on addressing systemic inequalities and supporting those most disproportionately affected during the pandemic. The Scottish Government has been working closely with local government and other partners to pursue this agenda, and we are progressing pilots in Glasgow and Dundee to target support aimed at reducing child poverty. Since the COVID recovery strategy was published, and particularly in recent months, rising inflation, the worsening cost of living crisis and the inaction of the UK Government has made it even more critical for the Scottish Government to focus its efforts on supporting those most in need. The fiscal environment we find ourselves in presents significant pressures. For example, inflation means that the Scottish Government's budget is now worth around £1.7 billion less than it was in December 2021. Despite these real and significant challenges, the Scottish Government is taking action to help, including extending and increasing the Scottish Child Payment to £25 in November, freezing rents and introducing a moratorium on evictions to protect the roofs over people's heads this winter, expanding free school meals, widening the Warmer Homes Fuel Poverty Programme and freezing rail fares until at least March 2023. This is in addition to the almost £3 billion in support that's already budgeted for and an existing £800 million of relief for business in this financial year. Recent announcements from the UK Government regarding energy prices are welcome, but do not go far enough. They certainly do not materially change the Scottish budget position in the current year, and we face a challenging period ahead financially. We are undertaking an emergency budget review to assess any and all opportunities to redirect additional resources to those most in need, to reduce the burdens on businesses and to stimulate the Scottish economy. The Scottish Government will publish the emergency budget review in the week commencing 24th of October. Any changes to budgets through this or other measures we've already taken in year will be formally set out to Parliament in the budget revision process, as is the standard approach. I'm very happy to answer any questions from the committee.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. We intend to conclude this session by 11 a.m, so members will approximately have 10 minutes each to ask questions to the Deputy First Minister. We should be okay for time this morning. However, I apologise in advance if time runs on too much and may have to interrupt members or the witnesses in the interests of brevity. I'll now turn to questions, and if I may begin with the first question, Deputy First Minister. Could I ask you to please provide some more detail on the scale of the ongoing COVID-19 spend?
The ongoing COVID-19 spend is primarily focused on a range of measures. It's focused on the surveillance activity that is underway, which is looking at some of the elements such as the ONS survey, the routine testing within GP surgeries, in the wider healthcare system and in the care system. So we're funding those elements to enable us to have that intelligence. There will be the routine approaches around other elements of the intelligence gathering, such as wastewater analysis, and around about the ONS infection survey, for example, and then the wider work that carries on in relation to the activity of the test and protect arrangements that we have in place.
Thank you. Just in the previous session this morning, we had Professor Andrew Morris, who has published the interim report on pandemic preparedness, and there are four big tick recommendations in that interim report. Can I ask the Deputy First Minister, will the recommendations of the interim report be reflected in the next budget?
Obviously, we're at a stage where we are in the formulation of the budget, but obviously the recommendations that have been made from the Standing Committee on Preparedness are recommendations we will consider very carefully. The work that Professor Morris is leading is very significant in making sure that we have the necessary level of external challenge. Obviously, there's other elements of challenge. Parliament and this committee are principal elements of challenge in that respect, to ensure that we have in place the necessary arrangements. But obviously, the recommendations that come from the Standing Committee will be provisions that we will look at very carefully as we take decisions about the approaches that we take. In this financial year, we have forecast expenditure of about £485 million on all of the aspects of the activities in relation to COVID, and we'll be obviously reflecting on those points as we consider the composition of the budget for the next financial year.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. I know that you briefly touched on this in your introduction, but following the UK's fiscal announcement last week, and we won't get any further information, I think, to the 23rd of November at this stage, would the Deputy First Minister be able to update the committee on any changes to the Scottish Government's fiscal timetable and the Scottish Government's approach to budget setting?
It's a very live issue just now, Convener, because I have to take forward dialogue with the Finance Committee to agree a timescale. The protocol between the Government and the Committee, the Government and Parliament, I should say, requires us to negotiate a timetable for that. Obviously, the fact that we now know that there will be another UK statement of some sort, I think it's unlikely to be a budget on the 23rd of November. I think it's more likely to be a provision, an assessment about the condition of the public finances and the debt reduction arrangements that are required. I'd be surprised if it's a full budget in late November. But we will, accompanying that, get the OBR analysis of the fiscal measures that have been taken, and from that we will then be able to engage through the, well, the Scottish Fiscal Commission will be able to undertake their work, and we will obviously be able to pursue a budget thereafter. So that all of that leads me to the conclusion that I think it's highly likely there will be a Scottish Government budget published before the end of the calendar year.
Okay, thank you, Deputy First Minister. If I could move to Murdo Fraser, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. There's a couple of areas I'd like to explore. First, to follow up on the Convener's first question, which is about the strategic framework. And we've taken quite a lot of evidence over the last few weeks about the ongoing costs of COVID-19 and preparedness across the public sector for potential future variants coming forward or a rise in cases. So, for example, the NHS has to maintain investment in vaccination, in surveillance, in PPE. And you mentioned the figure of £485 million in the current year. Now, I appreciate, you know, I wouldn't expect you to come up with any numbers, but projecting ahead, would you expect in next year's budget a similar figure to be required, or something lower? I mean, what is your thinking about the level the public sector will require to invest in against the risk of a future outbreak?
I think it's a fascinating approach from Mr. Fraser to say to me that he doesn't expect me to come up with a number and then ask me to come up with a number. So it's
a vague number.
I suppose God loves a trier. But I think it's clear that we must continue to make provision. So this is not a provision that we can consider is satisfactorily addressed. There will be ongoing commitments to what I would describe as a precautionary regime that we have in place, which is looking at, you know, today we have an enhanced level of biosecurity and PPE use today compared to pre-pandemic. So that will have to be sustained fiscally. We will have to retain sufficient intelligence gathering capability to give us the confidence to be able to properly address the issues you've just been addressing with Professor Morris. So I won't be pinned down on particular numbers today because there's a lot of work yet to be done. But the committee can expect there will be ongoing provision to support COVID, and it has to be of a commensurate scale to enable us to be confident that we have the measures in place to protect against any resurgence or any mutation of the virus. In that respect, COVID has not become part of the firmament of society yet, because in a lot of other viruses and conditions are very routinely handled within our public service provision. I think COVID is still in a category of its own, and therefore funding will need to reflect that.
Okay, thank you very much. I do appreciate you can't put a figure on it, but it's interesting to get your understanding. There will be ongoing costs. We heard in evidence, when we took evidence, for example, from COSLA about some of the pressures on their budget. We heard something similar from NHS representatives. Would you expect there to be in the budget for next year a specific budget line about additional resource being put in to, for example, local government or NHS trusts to reflect the issues that you've just highlighted?
The issues of funding provision, for example, on COVID, for example, on local government, I wouldn't expect that to be a distinct budget line, because I'm trying generally to move away from the over-prescribing the local government budget. I think local government I'd be surprised if local government was saying anything to the committee other than the fact that they would like to have as much flexibility over the budget as they can to meet the outcomes that both local government and the Scottish Government are interested in achieving, and that very much is reflected in the joint work we're taking forward on the COVID recovery strategy. And just for completeness, I should say that the board that supervises the delivery of that strategy is jointly chaired by the government and COSLA. I chair it alongside the president of COSLA. So it's a really valuable joint endeavour that we have. I think the best way to address the point that Mr. Fraser raises is to recognise that for both the health service and local government today are under enormous financial pressure. And Mr. Fraser, the committee will be familiar with the statements I have made to Parliament over since Parliament returned in the summer. In exercising my temporary responsibilities for financial management within the government, it is clear to me we are facing enormous financial strain in this financial year as a consequence of the effect of inflation. That will be affecting inflation and public sector pay costs. That will be affecting every budget across the public sector. So what I can say is I expect to be dealing with intense pressure within the public finances, and I also fear that I will be dealing with some reduction in public expenditure when I look at what the Chief Secretary is now saying is likely to be the approach to create financial stability, that there will need to be reductions in public expenditure to provide that route map to financial stability. And obviously I very much regret that, because that will add to pressure that we have significant pressure with which we are already wrestling.
Okay, thank you. You mentioned public sector pay. The resource spending review envisages public sector pay being held at 2022-23 levels. Now that's prior to, of course, the increases that have been agreed. But even at that level, it anticipated that if overall total public sector pay was to remain the same, but with some increases in pay rates, that would infer a reduction in headcount across the public sector. If that is to happen, where is the reduction going to come?
That will obviously be a material factor within the budget. Mr. Fraser is correct that the resource spending review envisages a reduction in public sector employment over the course of the spending review. We have to live within our means, and the public sector workforce has grown during the course of the pandemic, and we now need to take steps to ensure that that is sustainable, or the level of public sector employment is sustainable within the resources that we have available to us. It will obviously be a product of the discussions that are taken forward in relation to the budgets that are available for individual areas of public expenditure, and from that will flow the implications for public sector employment. There is, of course, an additional variable beyond the resource spending review. Well, there's two additional variables. One is whether the resource spending review is actually sustained in the resources we have available. And just now, I think it would be reasonable to assume that public spending at English departmental level, which is what matters in terms of our availability of funding significantly, that is likely to reduce given the difficulties that in the sustainability of the public finances that are currently being experienced. So that may be, the funding available to us may well be reduced from what we expect. Secondly, we have we're dealing with much higher inherent costs as a consequence of the pay deals in this financial year, which are much higher than we envisage them to have been. And thirdly, is the point of real uncertainty we have about the period for which we have to deal with much higher inflation. And that we don't yet have the answer to that question, but it's material to the financial volatility with which we are wrestling just now.
Okay, thank you. And one more question, Convener, if I may, just to interrogate further on this. I mean, I have constituents who have contacted me who, for example, are employed in the track and trace, and that programme is coming to an end, so their contracts are up. So these are people who were previously working in the public sector who will no longer be working in the public sector, and I think that's understood. And you know, there might be a need to re-energise that at some point should it be required, but that will be a loss of headcount. So that's understood. But do you anticipate, when you're talking about potential headcount reductions in the public sector, going beyond that?
Essentially, the question is, you know, it's impossible for me to answer that question just now without certainty over where the budget is heading in the years to come. And I won't know the answer to that until I see, well, I hope I know the answer to that when I see the outcome of the UK government statements on the 23rd of November. Now, it depends what information we get at that stage, and this is a genuine point of anxiety for me, because we saw a fiscal event on Friday which did not give us a complete picture of the financial information that is necessary. If we get another repeat of that in November, then I will be trying to construct a budget which will be based on a number of variables that might include significant risk for us. So if I don't know firmly what is the expected budget of the United Kingdom government for 23-24, that adds significant variability and uncertainty into the budget that I've got to set for that period. So there will be, we'll have clearer answers to that question when we get through the budget process.
Thank you.
Thank you. Alex Rowley, please.
Good morning. NHS 5 board met on Tuesday, and the finance director there reported that the Scottish Government were in discussions with the board to claw back COVID funding that had been allocated. And
I wish we could claw back Brexit, Mr. Rowley.
COVID funding that had been allocated, I think, earlier this calendar year. So you have IGB boards, for example, sitting with millions in reserves. Can you confirm that the Scottish Government have notified health boards that they want that money back, and what the thinking is around that, and what that funding is going to be used for?
I can confirm that the government is engaged in dialogue of that type with IGB, with integrated joint boards. We have got to make sure that the resources that are available to us to meet the financial pressures that we face. Again, Mr. Rowley will be familiar with the statement that I made to Parliament early on in September. We have to make sure that whatever resources are available to us are able to be utilised to meet the enormous in-year pressures that we face during this financial year. So those discussions are underway.
Because I think some of the discussion that took place at the board, my understanding and the concerns that board members raised, are around the lines of recovery. And at a time when they are trying to plan, as I understand it, NHS 5 have or are resubmitting a further recovery plan, they're making the case for further funding, further resources. At the same time as that, you must acknowledge yourself that social care is in a bit of chaos in terms of the impact it's having in terms of the hospitals where people are bed blocking. You've got massive waiting times in communities for care packages. And so you can understand where people are looking at, it just doesn't seem joined up in terms of local recovery plans to try and tackle the social care crisis, to tackle the crisis within the NHS. And at the same time, Scottish Government saying we want to claw back the money that you got. I mean, what is the difference, I suppose, with the COVID funding being used for recovery? And how do you define what is COVID recovery? Because
I think all these things are joined up, because, and you know, Mr. Rowley and I have probably talked about this issue as much as we've talked about any other issue over recent years. We have congestion in our A&E departments, which the A&E data on Tuesday demonstrates to be the case. Part of that is to do with congestion in our hospitals in general. It's not straightforward to get people out of A&E into other parts of the hospital if they need to stay there, or even if they go out of A&E to go back home because they may need care to support them at home. And so we've got congestion in our hospitals, and then in the community we've got challenges over the availability of care packages, not, I would say, because of a lack of money, but because of a lack of people. We've low unemployment, we've got staff shortages within the care sector. Obviously, we've just taken a decision in partnership with local government to substantially increase pay for low earners within the local government sector, which I know is an issue that matters very much to Mr. Rowley. And that's part of a measure to try to boost the attractiveness of many of these occupations so that we can attract more people, to expand the number of care packages that we're able to provide, and that we can provide more care and support to individuals. So all of this is interrelated, and some of the work that we're undertaking is designed to improve the attractiveness of professions so that we, as a consequence, we've got more people around, which helps to boost morale so that people feel less, less tired, exhausted by the work they're having to do. We've got, and as a consequence, the system attracts more capacity, and we can therefore handle more cases in a more efficient fashion. So, but the common theme of all of this is it's got to be paid for, and we're simply trying to use the resources that are available to us to make sure the system is well supported financially to enable it to operate efficiently.
I hadn't intended to get drawn into the social care discussion, but given that you've taken me there, I mean, so the IGBs are sitting with millions that's now going to be clawed back. And the question there, I think, is so I understand you want to take that money back out of the reserves. What is that money going to be used for? But in terms of planning, so let's look at Fife again. Fife now, over 60%, I think 62% or something, of social care provision, care at home, is provided through the private sector. There's less than 40% of care at home being provided in Fife directly through the council. The issue in terms of recruitment and retention is that 60-odd percent being provided by the private sector, that's where the greatest problems are, because the pay in terms and conditions, as the Deputy First Minister knows, the inequality between the pay in that sector and the pay within the public sector is massive. And they can't recruit. An example of that, 25 pence a mileage allowance for care workers delivering that 60-odd percent of care. In the public sector, it would be 42, 43, whatever it is, pence per mile. So you can imagine during the fuel crisis how those people struggled even more. Private companies have told me that staff were leaving. They couldn't afford to pay the petrol to get to the clients. We know the terms and conditions inequality exists here. So my point to you would be, unless you address that or bring the whole thing back in-house and tell councils to deliver the care at home in-house, you're not going to tackle that problem. And so my final point on that is, what I can't see is a joined-up strategy sitting there right now and a joined-up plan to actually finance that. And by the way, the NHS Board and Fife are reporting that they're about 10 million in the red projected right now. So you can see where board members are thinking, well, they're clawing back millions at the same time as we're in the red, at the same time as our services are in utter chaos. I just can't see the joined up approach and plan to that.
Well, obviously, I think if the government was to direct local authorities to bring all of this work in-house, I think there'd be a number of members of Parliament from a number of different traditions would be saying that's the government centralising things once again. So we've got to be kind of, I'm not looking at anyone in particular, but so we've got to be, you know, I think we have got to acknowledge that there is a degree of local decision-making that is required here, but ultimately a health board and a local authority working together through an integrated joint board have a duty to ensure that the needs of individuals are met, and they've got to make sure they've got a sustainable service in place. And the points that Mr. Rowley puts to me are all entirely legitimate points, but it might encourage a decision locally to be able to take more of this in-house to enable some of those issues to be better addressed. And in some cases, may have to be brought in-house because there won't be the private providers to actually deliver the alternative services. I come back to what I said in my earlier answer. This is all joined up in the sense that it's ultimately all got to be paid for. And we've got to make sure the resources available to us at a time of intense financial pressure. Mr. Rowley went through there a whole series of real tangible pressures that our public services are under. I don't dispute any one of them. But it's a measure of the scale of financial challenge we face. I've just been to the Social Justice Committee this morning, and I told the committee that after having served for 9 years as Finance Minister, through the financial crisis, through the period of austerity of the Conservative and Liberal coalition, I thought I'd seen challenges in public spending. They are as nothing compared to what I'm now wrestling with in my temporary period as Finance Secretary today. The situation is much more grave, and I'm very pessimistic about the outlook on public expenditure, given what I'm hearing from the UK Treasury overnight on revisions to public spending. So, the Chief Secretary told me on Friday he hoped to stick with the comprehensive spending review allocations for future years. I'm now seeing departments being asked for savings immediately. That makes me very fearful for what lies ahead, because if that changes at a UK level, an English public expenditure level, that will have a negative effect on us.
I'm going to go to
Mr. Mason, and once we go around members, I'll come back to you. Thank you.
Thanks very much, convener. I think we're now at the stage where, whether I ask you a question at the Finance Committee or here, it's similar questions. We're very much overlapping this committee with the other committees. But to kind of build on the whole cost side of things, we had evidence, and I know it's been mentioned already today, that we'll going forward we have higher levels of PPE, for example. There may be labs that were built or created during COVID which were mothballing and keeping in place. So I'm just kind of wondering how we get this balance right. It's back to this question of preventative spend. I mean, so much preparing for another pandemic is preventative spend, which is a good thing. But we've got these pressures, which you've just been discussing with Mr. Rowley. So, I mean, how do you see it going forward, not just this year, but in future years? How do we get the balance right between being prepared and reacting to what's happening now?
It's a very careful risk judgment that's got to be applied, but it's not the only risk judgment that's got to be applied across a range of different projects within the health service, within the public services. Nobody would thank us, given the experience that we've had between 2020 and 2022, if our level of pandemic preparedness was not adequate for the challenge. There's Lady Poole is convening a public inquiry on the pandemic, and one of the questions that she will explore is pandemic preparedness, and that will look at, what was government doing before COVID struck? What was pandemic? Because it was in, a global pandemic was one of the top risks in every annual risk assessment the government has ever produced. It was right up there. The question is, to what extent are you prepared for it? My answer to Mr. Fraser was in the earlier part of the session was designed to say that there are certain things we will be doing operationally of a routine level that are now stronger than our provision pre-pandemic. So PPE provision and biosecurity measures, I would say, are in that category. There will be surveillance arrangements that are stronger than they were in the past. Now, if that's all done and we don't have a pandemic, we could be exposed to criticism for spending public money on stuff that wasn't going to happen. Alternatively, people could say, well, that's actually a reasonable assessment of the level of risk that society faces, and the government is right to prepare on that basis. And that's the type of approach that I'd like to see us planning for, and making sure we're prepared, but also that we have the capacity to increase our footprint should it be necessary.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think that's a reasonable answer. I just think going forward, you know, 5-10 years, it'll be a different lot of politicians, I guess, around the table on the whole, and you know, how willing they'll be to put resources into preventative spend, I do not know. We mentioned Professor Morris and his report. Is the government, you said the government was considering it, the interim report, is the government actually responding to him at this point, or are they waiting for the final report?
Well, we're obviously engaging with Professor Morris. You know, we have a number of discussions with Professor Morris. I wouldn't want to characterise it as we are simply waiting for the end of a process. That's an ongoing dialogue to understand what questions the committee is looking at and what's the likely direction of travel that will come out of that. And arising out of that, you know, we will take steps to ensure that we're responding appropriately rather than waiting to the end of the process to make a formal response.
Okay, thanks. And another area, we took evidence, we've had quite a lot of varied evidence, but one was from the OECD, and the whole issue of what a resource spending review is. And their suggestion was that it's slightly different in Scotland and the UK from other countries, and that other countries, there seems to be more of an emphasis on examining what you are spending money on at the moment. Now, I mean, I don't know if you saw any of that or have picked up on any of that, but I just wondered if you felt there was any validity in that, the point that the OECD was making?
I think there's a... You know, I think one of the challenges of deciding our priorities in public expenditure is about assessing what is the most effective use of public expenditure at any given moment in time. And I think we've got to be open to that debate, because the world changes, life changes. You know, we didn't have a pandemic until 2020. And then, you know, we're having to provide in our budget in 22-23 for £485 million for pandemic activity. So I think it's important that public expenditure decisions keep pace with the needs of the time and the agenda that the government is pursuing. But I think for completeness, I would have to say having that discussion is not straightforward, because if I was to say, right, we're not spending £485 million on pandemic preparations, if I call it that, we're instead going to spend £50 million, I think there might be a lot of folks saying, what on earth is Swinney doing cutting the pandemic preparedness by £435 million. So I'm not sure that, you know, Mr. Mason's been served in this Parliament and in Glasgow City Council. He'll be familiar with the debates about public expenditure. There's not a queue of people queuing up to say, let's stop spending money on that to spend money on this. Mm-hmm. And that's indeed many of the issues that I've rehearsed with the Social Justice Committee this morning.
I mean, do you think in practice it's different in other countries, or are they just facing the same issues, just in a slightly different way?
I suspect we all face the same dilemmas, because nobody's ever got, you know, more money than they actually require. So it's always prioritisation got to be undertaken. And I suspect other countries probably don't find it any easier than we do to stop spending money on one item to spend it on another. But the process that I'm having to go through just now in my statement to Parliament on the 7th of September was a very clear example of this. I'm having to exercise a very challenging judgment about prioritisation.
OK, thanks, Camille.
Thank you. Brian Whittle, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. When we look at the impacts of COVID, and we continue to learn, I'm sure we will, the impacts of COVID, we do know that the effects of COVID are disproportionate on the older population, on those with conditions like obesity and diabetes and poverty, and as I said, we have an ongoing learning in that. So I've had this conversation with yourself before and with the Health Secretary about this potential here out of the back of COVID and the learnings from COVID to look at the way we deliver health and how we tackle health inequalities. And I think on many levels that is a very good target to have, not least of all for those experiencing it, but also there's a positive cost in terms of tackling health inequalities. And I wondered whether or not, Cabinet Secretary, the government are considering exactly that. We've had, we've had positive conversations about this. What are the government doing out of the back of COVID to look at the way in which we deliver health services and other services that will tackle health inequalities?
I think a lot of the thinking that needs to be done has actually been done, and it was largely done by the Christie Commission all those years ago. So I don't actually think that we've got a question to which we don't know the answer. I think we do know the answer, and the answer revolves around about prevention and early intervention. So if I can then translate that into the questions that Mr. Whittle is putting to me about the role and the approach of the health service, an approach which is much more about encouraging people to live a healthier lifestyle, to be active in addressing their weight, to be active in addressing how they manage any conditions or experiences they have. All of that is a crucial role for the health service. So I think we know all that approach, and indeed that's reflected in our wider public health policies, you know, where we will have measures around, you know, minimum unit pricing of alcohol, around about some of the advice about dietary issues, all these kind of questions. It's all part of our agenda. I think what COVID has the opportunity to do is to essentially force us to face up to that. It's almost the kind of turning point moment where, because of our experience in COVID, we all think, you know, we can do things differently. We should do things differently. So a kind of almost a prompt, a reset moment. And the COVID recovery strategy was designed to really provide the vehicle for that to happen. And if you look at elements of the COVID recovery strategy, a fundamental part of that is a lesson from COVID that if we actually deliver person-centred public services, we will make more impact on individuals and are likely to deliver better outcomes. That was our experience during COVID. So, for example, during COVID, because of the restrictions, households who faced difficulties weren't able to be contacted by the multiple agencies that would normally be knocking on their door to offer them support. What we deduced during that period was that people actually liked that, because they built up a relationship with the one trusted person who was coming to the house, who actually, instead of saying, turning up saying, you know, I'm from the council and I can offer you this, and I'm from the health service and I can offer you that, they turned up and had a conversation which said to people, what do you need? How can we sort things out? How can we make things better for you? And it might have been about food, it might have been about access to particular public services, whatever. But basically, people had a better experience of that. So the COVID recovery strategy is designed to get us into that mindset and that mode of delivery to try to do it. And the programme board that I chair, along with the president of COSLA, and which involves representation from a range of different public services, is designed to help us to drive that agenda. And indeed, the Pathfinder approaches that were taken in Dundee and Glasgow are providing very good learning about how that can be done.
Thank you. I think that's very helpful, Cabinet Secretary. I think the reason I decided to take this line of questioning is the fact that the Christie Commission report has been out for some time, and quite frankly, I think it's a failure of all of us in this place that hasn't been implemented in the way it should have been. And I think the evidence to the Health, Social Care and Sports Committee around tackling health inequalities noted that COVID pandemic had exacerbated health inequalities that were already on a rising trajectory, and actually were concerned that we were going to go back to business as usual. And I hosted a health inequalities reception a couple of days ago, and one of the deep end doctors kind of described it to me in a way that I haven't heard it before, in terms of the way that we deliver health services, that they're designed on demand, not on need. And I'm warned by the thought that perhaps we have an opportunity here to grasp a hold of the way in which we deliver health services to tackle this kind of health inequality. And I just want to know, you know, are the government really committed to doing that? Because as I said, you'll know the inverse care law here, that there's 20% of our population don't access healthcare, and they are the ones that are in most need. So how is the government going to tackle that?
Well, I think any reading of the COVID recovery strategy would say that the big lesson the government takes from COVID is the necessity, the imperative of tackling inequality. And that is then reflected in the contents of the programme for government as was set out earlier on this month by the First Minister. Now, these issues matter in, I think, two principal respects. The first is in relation to the point that Mr. Whittle concentrates on, which is about actually changing provision to make a difference to the experience of individuals, and that is absolutely correct, and to generate better outcomes. But there's a direct relationship to the issues that Mr. Rowley has raised with me, and a second observation, which is all of this work is critical to reducing demand on the health service, because if people are presenting at A&E inappropriately because they're not generally healthy and looking after themselves and all the rest of it, that is an interaction in A&E which is unnecessary, if I can use that word. If they were better supported within their community, within their own home, they may be able to avoid making that journey to A&E. And if they don't make that journey to A&E, then we've got one less person adding to the pressure that's already on our hospitals. So it's critical to the efficient operation of our public services.
I think just by on that point, really, then as I said, I think it's the direction of travel. You yourself have said it's the direction of travel you would like to go. Cabinet Secretary for Health has said exactly the same. But the truth of the matter is we are an unhealthy nation. And in the Cabinet Secretary for Health's own words, we are getting sicker, which is compounding the problems at A&E. So I'm really looking for some action here. What the government is going to take really is some action to tackle that health inequality, because we've talked about this a lot. The Christie Commission report's been around a long time.
I think I'm more optimistic about the taking forward of the Christie Commission than Mr. Whittle is. I think a lot of good stuff has been done over the years. I'm not going to sit here and say that everything's been done, or that as much has been done as I would have liked to have been the case. I do think a lot of proactive early intervention work has been undertaken, but we need to do more of it. And the COVID recovery strategy and the focus on specific tangible measures about how we might do that is the focal point for that activity. But I think the crucial point, and I've aired this within this committee before, is that we have to remain absolutely focused on the central purpose of that activity, which is to reduce inequality in our society, because inequality was in existence pre-COVID, it got worse during COVID, and we've now got to use COVID recovery to address that.
Thank you. I'll move to Jim Fairley, please.
Thanks very much, Convener. I'd like to go back to the evidence sessions that we had last week. We had Sarah Watts from COSLAN. Her comment was, not only is demand for services increasing, but all of the crises that are out there in social care, business support, and all sorts of areas that local government, but the cost of providing services is huge because of inflationary pressures. With Mary Spowage talking about the UK fiscal event that has just happened on the 23rd, obviously they were speaking before the fiscal event had happened. And she said there are huge implications for the Scottish budget if the UK government fundamentally decide to change devolved taxes in England, which we now know has happened. It could mean there's a boost to income for the Scottish budget envelope, but we don't know how much detail we'll get about the spending plans, which could have also consequentials. So not only is there huge pressure, but also huge uncertainty. I worry about the amount of detail we'll have to be able to give more certainty to both Scottish Government and local government. And then listen to the Chief Secretary of the Treasury this morning. I don't see any more clarity other than the fact that those spending decisions are going to be tight, regardless of whatever envelope budget may come to the Scottish Government. Could you expand on that for us to understand?
Certainly. The fiscal event on... to give a complete picture, there has been growing pressure on the public finances for some years. The statement I gave to Parliament on the 7th of September is a statement that I was not obliged to make. I volunteered to give it because I wanted to be transparent with Parliament about the gravity of the public spending pressures that we face. We're operating in a fixed budget. I, by law, cannot revisit tax during the financial year. I cannot borrow for day-to-day spending. So we've got a fixed budget unless we benefit from any consequential funding because of changes in English departmental public spending during the year. So I went to Parliament and announced over £500 million of spending reductions and changes to be open with Parliament about the gravity of the difficulty we face. That's a product of rising inflation and pay costs that are far in excess of what we expected because of the inflation. So that's where we are. That's where we were last Thursday. On Friday, we then had the fiscal event, which in this financial year generates a positive Barnett consequential of £35 million to the Scottish Parliament, the Scottish Government, which is from changes to stamp duty in England. There are, and then in subsequent years, there's further Barnett consequentials, but of course there are changes in tax interactions between Scotland and England, and there's plenty of voices demanding that I make the tax changes that the UK government has made to deliver those in Scotland. When we look forward, so we have some line of sight about the tax position, but you know I'm not at all confident as I sit here today that that tax position is going to hold, because I think there's huge market volatility in the last 48 hours has been horrific. So how that will all hold, I think, is anybody's guess. And it doesn't look like it's getting any more stable this morning. The Chief Secretary to the Treasury told me...
When you say that tax position won't hold, can you explain what you mean? You mean
might not
they
last.
Might have to reverse that?
Yeah, of course. Right. You know, if the UK financial system is going to collapse, they'll have to change it. And it's a mess this morning, an absolute mess. Total mess. Never seen anything like it in my life. So how that'll prevail, I have no idea. Add to that then, and why is that happening? It's because the markets don't believe the UK any longer believes in fiscal sustainability. So if the UK government wants to prove to the markets that it still believes in fiscal sustainability and it wants to protect that tax position it set out last Friday, it's only got one place to go. Reducing spending, which is why you heard the Chief Secretary on the radio, on the television this morning, why Mr. Fairley heard the Chief Secretary on the radio, the television this morning, talking about the need for departments to tighten their belts. And what that translates into plain English is spending cuts. So the Chief Secretary told me on Friday that he hoped to maintain the comprehensive spending review fiscal envelope for the remaining period, But I now hear a message which is about further restraint, and I can't see how that further restraint will happen without it having a negative effect on the budget in Scotland. So the outlook for our budget, I think, is pessimistic.
Okay. We also heard from Dr. Lucas Hart last week. He's the policy engagement lead for the Wellbeing Economy Alliance. Stressed the importance of the Scottish Government using existing devolved tax powers to support provision of further services, and that the Scottish Government may struggle to address inequalities with the current funding envelope set out. But he also said, I'm a bit surprised that this kind of funding limitation is so readily accepted. If there are powers the Scottish Government has in terms of local taxes, there are possibilities to think outside the box and challenge the idea that this is the money that we have. Are there areas that you're not thinking outside the box?
Well, Mr. Fairley should know me well enough to know that I'm thinking inside and outside the box on a constant basis. But you know, let's take a couple of these themes. The witness that Mr. Fairley cites talked about local taxation. Well, the government has legislated to enable local authorities to exercise a workplace parking levy, for example. That's not exactly been universally welcomed by all shades of opinion in this Parliament. There's the concept of a visitor levy. Again, it's all about giving power to local communities to make their decisions, and it's not. And we get encouraged to empower local authorities and local communities, and then we get criticised when we try to empower such local communities. So I don't think it's a straightforward question. In relation to the resources available to us, you know, we obviously have tax powers that we can exercise, and you know, my ministerial, well, my predecessors have taken decisions about tax rates which are different from the rest of the United Kingdom. I wholeheartedly support them. I think they're the right decisions that have been taken. Again, they are not universally popular. So we have used tax powers. I can't do that during a financial year. The law prevents me from so doing. But there are obviously those options available to us, and I have to reflect carefully on the fiscal event of Friday and what it's thrown up in relation to public, in relation to taxes. As I determine what will be the position of the Scottish Government.
OK. The other thing that Dr Hart said was, we know that council tax reform is well overdue. We know that council tax is well overdue because it is very regressive. We know the Scottish Government has powers over income tax bans that it hasn't looked, made a lot of use of, which I'm not quite sure if I understand what he means there, but perhaps you might. So even though there are good reasons for that not being looked at in more detail, the spending review is a five-year spending review, so I was surprised that more information on raising finances was not there. Is that a criticism you can...?
I don't think so. You know, obviously, people might want us to do more and tax than we're prepared to do, but we've got to look at all the aspects of the fiscal sustainability of individual tax decisions. You know, I think there's a difference between, you know, in terms of the composition. You know, if we basically had tax powers and had just used them in exactly the same way as the United Kingdom government, then I could see why that criticism was valid. But we've not. We've had a barload of criticism for the different decisions we've taken on tax. I think they've been entirely reasonable and appropriate decisions, but we've got a lot of criticism for so doing. So I'm not, I don't really buy that criticism at all. On council tax, I would accept that I've been an advocate for alternatives to the council tax, but there's never been a parliamentary majority to actually put any of these alternatives into practice. So trying to, you know, we're going to be doing some work on looking at local taxation to try to build wider agreement around what a reform package might look like, and that will be taken forward during this Parliament.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Thank you. We do have a bit of time at hand, so I'm going to take a few supplementaries. Alex Rowley.
Okay, thank you. Can I say firstly that in terms of, and I do understand the real risk that we now face in terms of public service cuts, I think you and I will stand shoulder to shoulder with millions across the country in opposing those cuts, if that's the route that they do take. But regardless of that, our services are in crisis right now. And really what you're confirming to me is that the millions of pounds of reserves that are sitting in IGBs across the country is now going to be clawed back into the centre. And, you know, how that's to be spent, I know it's one-off spend, would be important to know. But crucially, there does not seem to be a joined-up plan at the local level to deal with the crisis that we have in health and in social care. And it's okay saying the councils can take or start to put some of the provision for home care back into the public sector. The only reason they put it out was because it was cheaper, and the only reason it was cheaper is because the pay terms and conditions of the workers, and that's why we can't get carers now, because they've treated them so appallingly. But you can't just pin it onto the council. We have the IGBs, we have the councils, we have the NHS boards. Somehow you need to instruct them to come together in a totally transparent way and produce local plans that show us how they're going to tackle the crisis in health and social care, that's then running into a crisis in our hospitals, that's then running into a crisis in an accident emergency, and we have people queued up for hours and hours in ambulances. We can no longer ignore it. We somehow need to instruct these bodies to come together and produce a plan that tells us how they're going to tackle it. Would you not agree?
I actually do agree with that, because there is a direct relationship between A&E congestion, delayed discharge, and social care in the community. These are three directly linked propositions. I think what Mr. Rowley fairly puts to me is, are they as connected in local planning? Because ultimately, it's people that are in there. In those three categories, A&E, delayed discharge, social care, they're people. And we've got to make sure services revolve around people, that they're built around people, as opposed to are delivered in little compartments where, and I don't mean any criticism of anybody with the language I'm just about to use, but that, you know, A&E deals with A&E. I suspect there's lots of A&E staff who would love there to be more activity in social care, because it might actually allow them to get around the A&E department slightly more easily than they are able to do just now, and that their day might not be quite as up against it as every single day is. So the A&E folk will be focusing on the A&E problem in front of them, but they need the rest of the system to be dealing with the social care issues so that the A&E problem becomes not as significant as it is. And so there has to be cohesion amongst that. And the players in all of this are the local authorities, the health boards, the integrated joint boards, and the care providers. Those are the people that have the key to all of this. And there are arrangements in place to ensure planning is undertaken to deliver these services in a cohesive way. I think the challenge that we face just now is that the work that is going on is not delivering the outcomes that we need it to deliver, because A&E is too congested, delayed discharges are too high, and social care provision is not as extensive as it needs to be. So what's driving that? Well, I think, and amongst all this, unemployment's at 3%. So I deduced from that, and Mr. Rowley mentioned it earlier on inadvertently, but I'm afraid we go back to Brexit, because I can't speak for Fife. I don't represent the Kingdom of Fife, but I represent the County of Perthshire. And if I was to go into a care home in my constituency prior to Brexit, I would have encountered a lot of people who'd be working there who would come from Eastern European countries. Lovely people, faithfully looking after our loved ones in our community and delivering home care packages. I can think of folk as I sit here, folk that I know well, they've now gone. They've gone back home because they didn't feel welcome after Brexit. Our working age population, Mr. Rowley knows, he doesn't need me to tell me, our working age population has been declining for 20 years. And it's now got critical because of the population. It got temporary. We got temporary respite after the expansion of the EU in 2004. And we had all these years where folk came here, made their homes, contributed, looked after our loved ones, played the part in our community. And then we took part in the folly of Brexit in 2016, had it inflicted upon us. And as a consequence, we've lost these people from our population. So I think that's a big factor. I actually don't think money is the problem. It's the availability of people just now. That's the biggest problem we face. Except from what Mr. Rowley said to me, there's maybe not all the cohesion that we need. And I'll take that issue away. I'll give the committee that assurance. I'll take that away. I discuss this all the time with the Health Secretary because, you know, he understands that relationship between A&E, delayed discharge and social care. It's just as much as I do. So we totally accept the analysis of the problem. But we don't have all of the people that we need to make sure we can deliver that connect. If we can make it more connected, I'll endeavour to do so. I don't have a magic solution to the people question because we've committed folly in our decision making.
Thank you. Brian Whittle, please.
Thank you, Convener. I fancy putting a question to you, Cabinet Secretary, that I put to Professor Morris this morning. I think, and you alluded to it yourself, that you know, that a global pandemic is in the high risk category continually, and has been in the high risk category before. I think my analogy was that we know that an asteroid is going to hit the Earth at some time. We just really hope it doesn't happen during our tenure, kind of thing. And I think that that's kind of the governments across the world have been shown that they weren't as prepared as they perhaps could have been for a pandemic. And as we watched it, the pandemic, move across the world towards us, I think we started to learn that, as I said before, the age and obesity and diabetes and other conditions, more vulnerable conditions, were much more affected by COVID. And I wonder, in hindsight, it's 2020, and we have to use that as we plan forward, whether or not we can use that information and be more focused on how we prepare for a pandemic in the future, given that we recognise that vulnerability had such a huge impact on COVID outcomes. Are we able to slim down our approach looking back?
I think I'm deadly serious when I say that in literally every we have an annual risk assessment that's undertaken, and every year I've been a minister, a global pandemic will have been in that top category. And I can remember conversations that we've had before around different resilience tables and governments saying, we must be due a pandemic sometime soon. But it was always there, and you thought, surely. And of course, when it comes, it came with absolute ferocity, as any pandemic will come. And I think, to go back to the point that Mr. Mason put to me earlier on, we have to be ready for it. In that risk, if you take the top risks that the government assesses that we're exposed to, a global pandemic will be one. Increasingly, now, cybersecurity risks are up there. And then you have the natural issues that we have climatically in Scotland in general of winter weather, flooding, and the enhanced level of threat from climate change. So these are all the factors that we're there, and we've got to have a level of preparedness for all of those things. So we will have different flood resistance plans, flood alert systems that give us advance warning of circumstances that might be coming towards us. We judge them to be appropriate. We can't build flood defences in every single community to prevent to protect against every eventuality. We can make a risk-based assessment about where they're acquired. I was down in Hoyk just the other week there in Mr. Whittle's region, and there's huge construction works going on schemes there to protect from, it must be the River Teviot, I think, in Hoyk, where there's been flood damage in the past. So there we're responding to risk. When it comes to a pandemic, you know, fundamentally, there's a lot of things the state can do. So the type of steps that Professor Morris will have gone through with the committee this morning, the type of expenditure we undertake, the surveillance measures we have in place, these are all part of our equipping ourselves to be able to deal with these situations. But there will then be individual preparations. We know one big lesson from the pandemic, that the healthier you are, the more you'll have the capacity to resist the pandemic. So, you know, at a personal level, that should say to me, you know, how many times have you been out running this week, John Swinney? Well, we've got to Thursday and I've not been out yet, you know. So that's so same. So, you know, that's I ascribe that to the burdens of office. But you know, that it's how we, you know, how do we all take the steps to keep ourselves as healthy as possible? Because that's material to dealing with some of the issues Mr. Rowley was putting to me about congestion in our public services. The more I can keep myself healthy and away from A&E, that's probably the best thing I can do for A&E, is stay away from it and keep myself healthy. So there's a kind of societal level and an individual level that we've all got to take forward.
If I could finally then, another one of my pet lights on this is the application and deployment of technology. And the way in which technology helped in the way we tackled COVID. Where are we with that? I mean, I'm on record as saying that we're way behind the curve in healthcare tech and the way in which we could deploy that. Are the government considering technology or deployment of technology as part of pandemic preparedness?
I wouldn't say. I think I'd have to give us. I think I'd probably have to reserve my position on specifically on pandemic preparations, and if I need to give any specific information to the committee, I'll write to the convener about that point. But in terms of the use of technology, I think there's a huge role for technology in the management of healthcare. You know, if I can get information on my Fitbit thing here about my health condition, just based on, you know, me voluntarily having that information and being able to monitor my health and other factors, then surely at a system-wide level we can find ways of ensuring that we've got the support that technology could bring towards us in that respect. I met a really interesting company yesterday who are involved in the use of sensors for which are placed in people's homes to assess their movement, the steps they take, essentially to monitor vulnerability. You know, is somebody getting up at the right time? Are they moving around the house enough? Are they putting the kettle on? Are they cooking? All these to give early indications of, is there a need for support? Because if we can get support to that person at the earliest presentation of vulnerability, long before they come anywhere near a care home or a GP practice or an A&E department, that allows us to deliver better outcomes for that individual, and it also enables us to operate fiscal sustainability.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. I think we're veering slightly off the budget scrutiny agenda, but that concludes our consideration on this agenda item, and I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his officials for their evidence today. The committee's next meeting will be on Thursday, the 27th of October, when we will consider a draft letter to the Scottish Government on our pre-budget scrutiny. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning, and I will now move this meeting into private. Thank you.